Ron Bingley, I was told it should be called Mr. Pocatello Transportation, so I'll start it out that way. He graduated from Pocatello High School and Idaho State University, was college, that, no, West University. I graduated from Idaho State College, so you can tell my age. When he was there, he was the manager of the, what's it called? Holt.
Of the Mini Dome Security.
Mini Dome, thank you.
Yeah.
That's what it's called.
I didn't know we were going back that far.
All right, now we'll get better here. In 1976, he managed the SECA transportation program, Telebus, for senior citizens and persons with disabilities. And I'm going to jump ahead on that if you want to talk about persons with disabilities in Pocatello, this is the gentleman who has done more than anyone else in our city for the support of people, the elderly and the disabled.
Take out that United States thing.
Well, I got United States
well,
down
he
here
wrote
too.
It. I told you about that. I did not write that.
All right, well, I'm going to say it my way. I don't have to say it. He told me I could say it any way I want. Yeah. So be good. Okay. In 1982, he petitioned the city of Pocatello to create the transportation department and Pocatello Urban Transit. Then in 1987, at the request of cities and counties in the area, he set up the Pocatello Regional Transit. And that includes Power County and other cities outside of Ashe County. He was appointed as the ADA coordinator for the city of Pocatello and appointed to the National Association of ADA Coordinators Board. And the initials are all here, but I can't read them. When the PRT moved to the Greyhound Depot, he was instrumental in historic preservation of the building. You're going to hear more about the depot from me in a couple minutes. He retired in 2009, and got bored being retired, so he came back as a part-time bus driver.
They asked me to.
He's a prolific historian, and that's the part that I like as a historian. And he has a great deal of knowledge about local, national, and international history. And with that, Ron and Dave Hunt is here as his loyal supporters.
What I think we'll do is, without the PowerPoint, we'll have I'll just ramble on a little bit for you about the history of Telebus, Pocatello Urban Transit, Pocatello Regional Transit, up to the day when Brother Dave took over. He's not my brother, but I'm being kind. But anyway, no, just a joke there. But anyway, and I'll give you a little bit of history about Pocatello as public transit as we know it. And again, unfortunately, and I apologize, I can't show you these neat pictures we had. If we don't ever get the PowerPoint up, I can tell you we had a wonderful picture of the old Greyhound station in there, but we didn't actually have it in there, we forgot it. But I can say it was there because you're not going to see anything. Anyway, in 1914 to 1918, in the World War I era, we had a Pocatello streetcar. And its purpose was to run, and we had a picture of it, and it's a great old thing, and I hope some of you have seen it in other venues. Great old rubber tire streetcar. And as we understand, it was the first motorized public transit in Pocatello, but if it wasn't, it certainly was nearly so. And it ran from the academy to the downtown Pocatello, more or less. That's what it was doing, was moving students and others back and forth. After that, in the period of the 1920s, 1930s, pre-World War II and into World War II, we had a very active public transit system in Pocatello operated by private enterprises. Various private entities ran it, and it was profitable. I don't know if they got rich, but at that time, gas prices were very low, and a lot of people didn't have automobiles, and the demand was there. So you had volume, and that was a very good thing, and it was very needed. And I remember, actually, part of it when I was a kid, you used to have buses run out to Ross Park and everything. Some of you will remember that in Pocatello when private entities operated for many years. And then we started to get into the era of the 50s, and particularly the 60s and early 60s, when there was gas prices were expensive, capital was expensive, and many, many, many people had cars. Post-World War II, you will remember this, some of you by having lived it, and some of you having read about it. The reality was that all over this country, private bus providers were not making it. They were going out of business. In around the period of 1963 to 1965, well, we got something going there. 1963 to 1965 was the approximate period when the last bus in Pocatello operated by a private entity went out of business. And in 1964, the federal government recognized that it was in the national interest to have public transit make it, but all the private entities were falling away. In fact, about the last one was around 1969 in Minneapolis, or excuse me, in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, which had a very viable private system, but it finally gave up the ghost around 1969. Anyway, what the feds did was they passed the UMT Act, Urban Mass Transit Act of 1964, which provided funding for urbanized systems of 50,000 more so that they could use local match and gain through grants operating assistance for their public transit systems and capital assistance. But the requirement was it had to be a public body. In other words, that the a public body like a city or a transportation authority, but a taxing unit, had to be the recipients and sign the contracts for fulfillment of the grants. So no private entities could receive the money, and so therefore the Pocatello system went out of being in about 65, and we saw no public transit, actually public transit, for something in the neighborhood about 15 years. In 1972, so there was nothing in that period, as we mentioned. In 1972, there was a for perceived need and a need to help public to help senior citizens get to congregate meals at the senior center, and so they bought an old SECA, as it was, Southeastern Idaho Community Action Agency, a nonprofit, using Title III-B Older Americans Act funds, purchased. Oh, so now we're, so Dave points. He does nothing else today, but anyway, just kidding.
Just catch up to
are you going to click it for me or what?
You're all set there.
All right, okay,
so
where is
it? Just move forward and back using those buttons.
All right, okay. All right, so here's the trolley I talked about, the Pocatello streetcar. Good picture, isn't it?
Yes.
You've got to admit it's better than me just talking. All right, now, we've already gone through this, so we'll move ahead. This is the 20s and the 30s situation, the non-sustainability because of costs, you know, for private entities to provide public transportation. And basically, I think I just talked through that. This is the situation with the UMTA Act of 1964, which we discussed, and that it had to be for public bodies. And Pocatello was not at the required population. We were, I guess after Alameda merged with Pocatello, we were about 36,000, so we had no way to go. And this discusses that. And then in the 1970s, as we understand, 1972, the SECA organization, which I mentioned previously here, acquired an old excess property, Army bus. Oh, it was a sight, I'll tell you. And I remember it, do I ever. They called it the Old Green Hornet, and its purpose was to transport senior citizens back and forth to congregate meals, as I mentioned, and it was on the basis of a donation. There was no fare. No general public were eligible to ride it, and disabled people didn't ride it unless they were 60 years old. 60 years old and older was the cutoff for that. SECA was the nonprofit that operated it. And then between 1972 and 1976, we acquired, through basically SECA and the city of Pocatello, and the county of Bannock helped a great deal, with money, but we couldn't, as we mentioned, match any federal funds. But we did acquire about three or four vans between 1972 and 1976. And one of them was even had a raised roof on it, so you could walk right in, but there were no lifts. So I came around in about 1976, actually September 1976, and then I needed a job, so I had to make this work. Just kidding. Anyway, here's the old, pictures are neat, aren't they? This is the old, I remember when this used to be in 1958, it was a Ford garage or something like that. But anyway, this was the old Sika building. It looked better in that day, quite a bit better actually. And we had in 1976 a large closet, and that was the office for the what was called telebus in those days. All right.
What's the address?
What was that?
What is the address on that?
It was a 1356 North Main. It's right on the corner of Main Street and what's the side street?
Day.
Main and Day.
Do
any of you remember it?
Yeah.
Good. I remember one time they served, I used to go eat my lunch there, and one day they had I just love spaghetti. And I started eating, I said, something's wrong with this. I found out they made it out of elk meat. Threw me off. But, you know, I don't know why I told you that. But anyway, September of 1976 was the time I came around, and here's what we looked like a little bit in 1976. Here's the raised roof. Unfortunately, didn't have a lift on it. And a couple of the drivers. And here's some more of them. And maybe some of you remember Charlie Burns. Does anyone in here remember? He was the man. He was the one that looked after the senior citizens. And there's a young driver right there. No uniforms. That's a story all its own about how we acquired uniforms. I'll tell it right now. We acquired uniforms around 1978 or so for our drivers. They were green like Forest Service uniforms. And we did it because one of our drivers always wore these coveralls with the straps and his Hawaiian shirts, and we had to get out of that. So that's the reason we went to uniforms. Is that a true story, Dave?
That's before my time.
He's going to sit there and say that all through this, I'll tell you that. Okay, in 1978, the federal government said, okay, we've taken care of the urban areas, but what about the rural areas? And remember, Pocatello Chubbuck at about that time was under, based on the 1970 census, under 50,000, the combined of the two. So they created what was called a Section 18 rural service category, and it was only at the time for capital acquisition, called 20% match, 80% federal funds, and we acquired our first lift bus and actually made it possible for people with disabilities, regardless of age, to ride. And we also mentioned that we were in the old Salvation Army building on East Bonneville. Dave, what was that exact address? I don't know. Here's the telebuses that we acquired. We got them out of Ohio, Cincinnati area. There's that lift. Oh, those were rattly old lifts. They're nothing compared to what we've got nowadays. So if you haven't checked that out, you should, okay? If not necessary to use it, if you don't need it, just to see the difference in the technological development. Okay, that was in 1978. And this was around 1977, we moved from the extended closet over on North Main to the old Salvation Army building. Right here in the front, there were two offices. That was basically what we rented. There were a couple big areas, but we basically used that and kept our small fleet in that compound right out there.
And where was that one? Still,
where's that building? Where's it located?
Uh-huh.
It's Bonneville, but we wrote the address down somewhere for 300 something East Bonneville, I think. But that's probably wrong.
From where?
Let's see, it was the 300 block of East Bonneville. It's between 3rd and 2nd Street, on the north side of the street there. That's the best I can do for you right now. Okay, We talked about the Section 18, and when we acquired those four telebuses, those small, you can't walk in them, but you can go like this in them, buses, we also provided one for Lava Hot Springs. And so we were actually running the Pocatello system and some in Lava Hot Springs. And I wished I'd put the address on East Bonneville, but they didn't. So, and we mentioned that we were able to serve people with disabilities that need wheelchairs. And in 1979, we acquired an old, not acquired, rented, an old building on North Main Street. And we were able to, it was a loading dock is actually what it was. One area was the office for dispatcher and the one was for me, and there was nothing else. And then we were able to take our buses in and wash them in cold water and maintain them in the freezing. We didn't have any heat in that part. Things were rough in those days. This is the kind of what it looked like. I remember pulling those in right there, and the old loading dock was on the end, but I think it's since gone because this is a modern picture. In fact, yesterday. There's dear old Pokey High, and we were always building our own lifts, and we in around 1980 we started to move toward with that with the implementation of what we call Section 18 operating funds, now not just capital but rural funds to help us with operating on a 2080 basis. We started to think about a fixed route. There'd been a plan in Pocatello since the 1970s, which the council had mandated. We mentioned in here that we never followed that plan because the money was never there. So this was incremental, as needs could be met in an evolving way. And that's Arthur Street, I suppose. This is just some more verbiage about what we had done, and we'll go. Oh, I will mention that since we couldn't afford bus stop signs, we couldn't afford anything. We stenciled on the face of the curbs at our bus stops in that first year, 1980, one loop bus, and we stenciled the bus stop right there on the curbs. If you look real good, you might find some of those still around the city occasionally. Historical. All right. And here's one of our first drivers of fixed route bus. And we had actually acquired in 1980 or late 1959 two buses, new, that were called Transets. And they were, you could walk right in them. They were vans, but you could walk right in them. So, you know what? The public could ride then. There was a fare. Senior citizens, of course, could ride, and we maintained the demand response. In fact, that had been growing. The demand response service has always been for people with disabilities and for people who are 60 and over. Since the ADA in 1990, it's been required for us to provide some form of ancillary support to the fixed route for people with disabilities, but we've always included senior citizens who can be non-disabled in that door-to-door service and still to this day do that. Now, that is a lot more than some larger transit systems did. They met the minimum requirement and we expand on it. By June of 1980, and that's not up here, well, I guess it is, the census was showing or would show that Pocatello-Chubbuck would become an urbanized area of 50,000 or more. And this opened up the whole new era for us. Didn't make us rich, because remember, we've never had any dedicated state funds, and the local funds were generated from various and sundry sources, City of Pocatello, Bannock County, donations, what have you, but never a dedicated state fund in Idaho, and it's one of a couple states in the Union that don't have that to this day. But anyway, in 1980, in June, we created another loop. So we had a loop, a closed loop, a fixed route in Pocatello on those buses like we showed you. And then in 1982, when the official census came into being, we were able to get the federal funds. And at the same time, the city of Pocatello, we beseeched them to take us over. And the reason that we did that was because in the rural program, nonprofits could operate the system, but in the urban program, only public bodies could be recipients. Just as we told you about the UMTA Act in 1964, that was still the law. And if we had not got Pocatello or Bannock County to take over the transit system, we couldn't have operated because SECA could not receive the funds. They could have, we could have subcontracted to them, but that's all. Okay, and that happened, and we became part of the city of Pocatello in 1982. I hope we have some pictures of some of the buses that we acquired, but we were running out of time, I'm sorry to say. I have to apologize, but I'll tell you about it. Okay, we do have this one. This is Governor Andrus, Mayor Finlayson, and me, much younger, and Commissioner Castlemeade is there on the sidewalk. Those are the ones I can identify. Let me tell you about these buses because it was so wonderful. And then I will really quicken up and end this. We had been buying used buses from everywhere, Salem, Olympia, Washington, Eugene, Oregon, Boise, crates, really. And they were our fixed route buses, and I won't tell you about the one where the engine fell on the ground on the road, or the wheel fell off, but they're not like that anymore, by the way. But anyway, there were some stripper well funds, and the idea came to us, if we could get some of those stripper well funds that were being used, this was around 1986, 87, 88. If we could get some of those, we could match some federal dollars, because match was the only problem. There was plenty of federal dollars. And we cajoled and begged, you know, got on our knees and whatever, and convinced Boise it was in their interest to join. And once Boise joined, whoa, we're going to get the money. And Mayor Finlayson helped us a great deal. And we used the stripper well funds. The stripper well people who were in control of that agreed and gave us $100,000, and we were able to acquire four buses, one with air conditioning. And there you have what happened with the ribbon cutting. It was a big day for us, I promise you. This is the first time we'd ever bought a brand new fixed route bus, right? And here's some of the old ones that should have been before that one, I suppose. This is an old GM we bought from Los Angeles that they'd used in the Olympics. And there's an old thing we got out of, I think, Salem, Oregon. They look better than they were, promise you that. There were a lot of nifty things we got into to make us viable. Among the things we did about 1988 was to get on the ISU campus, and we told ISU that if this is successful, we'll expect you, or if you want to increase the size of the service on campus, for the shuttle on campus, then we're going to need some money from you. It incrementally grew and grew until the time when ISU said, yeah, this is good, and joined with us in providing us some local match. And to this day, I think, well, I won't give you any modern information, but anyway, we are still getting help from them. Then I from here on, I think we're just, oh, there it is. Now, hey, that's, isn't that a great picture? For those who love history, and I think somebody else is going to talk a little bit more about this building. But I will just say this, and then I think I'm going to shut up at this point and say that we continue to grow and we started working on trying to acquire a new facility, and that's going to be the Dave era, and she's getting up, and I'm done anyway. But I wanted to say that in 1979, Greyhound pulled out of this building, and we were able to use it. And we were squatters for about 5 or 6 years and finally made some arrangements with the railroad to pay for the land by rent and buy the building through the federal funds. And we used that from that little thing from 1979 till 2014. And that's all I got time to say. And Dave was going to tell you the rest next week. Thank you.
Transportation in Pocatello begins with your freight lines. And we've talked a lot about people moving, and I was going to go into the transportation. I thought, no, it's very simple. It's your freight lines. And
I was very lucky as a kid. I have to go back and tell you this. When I was in grade school, I lived in the same block as the Garretts. And I got to know Anson and Nancy and Mrs. Garrett. I didn't see him very much. For some reason, he was always off doing business. So I can tell you in all honesty, they were friends, but I kind of knew him. I put the dates down there for you to see because I found it was pretty extraordinary to see how rapidly this man, he came here, he bought this little convention here. 2 years later, you can see what he was. And if you look down through there, you can see actually what all he achieved. And by the time Clarence was done with all of his activities, he was the fifth largest transportation company in the United States. Unfortunately, with his death, the ability and the fortitude that he displayed kind of went by the wayside, and it ended up with us losing Garrett Freight Lines. I have a second story about Garrett Freight Lines, and then I was teaching for the school district and health and welfare, and for 10 years I taught in the Garrett building, so I kind of felt like I was there on both ends. These are some of the pictures, and there's an individual who owns all these, and he said online, if you want to use them, you can, and so I did. And these give you a background on where the some of the buses, what they looked like over the years, and some of the locations where these buses were located. Then, you're wondering, what the heck's Abraham Lincoln got to do with Idaho? Well, I don't know how many folks know this. I'm sure you do if you're around a few years ago, because I was in charge of Idaho 150 in this area, and that was when we became a county, became a territory. However, the interesting thing about Lincoln is they decided to build the Lincoln Highway, which was the start of the roads all across America. And I'm reading about it, and lo and behold, down at the bottom, all right, now you've seen everything, I believe. At the very bottom, it turns out that Pocatello was mentioned. And the thing I thought was interesting about it is it talks in terms of Highway 30. And so I thought it was really nice that the Lincoln Highway folks gave us a shout out. You each have a copy of this, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time going over this. This is the real crux of transportation, interstate, city transportation in Idaho, in Pocatello. And it really kind of gives you an idea of the early stage line. I saw that beehive stages, and I went online because usually online you find something about anything, and I couldn't find a blue thing. And then all of a sudden, I found this. And I went into newspapers and found actually an ad in spring of 1939 for, does that say 29? Should be 39. Both 29, sorry. Thank you, 29. There was an ad, including Pocatello, about that. And then there was the article that the Union Pacific stages had obtained the beehive. And I thought that was kind of cool. I was happy to see it said Pocatello, so that fit right in with what I was going to talk about. This is the Union Pacific stages as they looked when they were first taken over by here in Pocatello. So if you, some of you folks may remember, I was not quite born yet, so that's, I'm glad of that. And then there's another a little bit later. This was towards the end of the period. I was tickled to death to find this in online, particularly since it hit advertising the year I was born. And this kind of gives you an idea of what it was. Then I'm not getting the thing working too well here with the pointer, but if you look at the line across that goes across, you come up to that little V, that's Pocatello. So Pocatello was on the map at that point. I was able in that thing to actually find the bus route and the times from Salt Lake City through Pocatello to Yellowstone Park. That particular connection is perhaps the most important connection for Pocatello and has been for many, many years, both in rapid transit and in the bus transit, that we are, thanks to the road that we have, Highway 30, we get to be the one that everybody has to go through if they're going to Yellowstone. And I used to work when I was on the Revenue Commission. I always wanted to put a sign up on the road saying, if you're on your way to Yellowstone and you're tired, stop and rest at Ross Park in Pocatello. We got everything you want for your kids and for you, and you can relax and it won't cost you anything. Then I realized, yeah, well, we have to pay for the zoo and the swimming, but that's okay. This is the bus. It's in my friend who was just here last week, Thornton Wake. This is just before they put the sign up. So this is one of the first copies or pictures of the actual bus station. Here is when we went to Greyhound. There is all of the things, and again, if you come up there, you can see Pocatello made the major bus route. Again, because it was on the way to Yellowstone. Okay. This is some of the ads, and they're wonderful ads that you can find online. I had a great deal of fun, like I said. I said to put this together and thought, let's see, it's pretty, that needs some color. Okay. These are some of the earliest buses. Now, I do remember. I remember these buses. When I was a kid, my dad was the co-owner of Ford's Pool Hall downtown. And my mother was a telephone operator, so they put me down in one of the movie theaters. Or they'd send me down to the bus depot because people down there were friendly. And so they would be free candy bar. And I would tell people about Pocatello, and I was about eight. The other thing about it is every summer, I spend a month in Preston with my grandfather. And they would put me on the bus and send me down. And everybody at the depot knew me, so they would make sure that I was safe and I'd get down safely into Preston. My grandfather would be there. And then mom and dad would come and get me later. This is the map this was a map in 1978, and it shows the various bus routes. You can see, again, if you come up from Logan, that blue is Pocatello. It also shows the additional routes that we had at that time. Some of the buses came through here again, because that we were initially the connection up there to this other area of Idaho. So we did more than just Yellowstone. I was very pleased with that because it showed we did something else. Then we come to the modern. And this is where we are now with the Salt Lake Express. And I particularly wanted to show you the different buses because I have taken that to go to Salt Lake and go when I was catching a plane or just going down for the day. And every single time I've ever been on it, it seemed like it was a different bus. So I verified, yes, they did it. They did all those different buses. Now, we come to the part, and I've gone through this rapidly because I'm part of the Historic Preservation Commission for the City of Pocatello. And we have a goal. And our goal is to raise somewhere in the vicinity of $500,000 to $600,000. I'm not asking you for money today, but anyway, what we want to do is we want to repair and renovate the bus depot so that it looks like it did before, using the same materials, except for the roof, it's going to be better, and the air conditioning system is going to be far better. I've heard that's one of the biggest problems we had. And hopefully we won't have any leaks in the roof. But our goal is to make, in May of this year, is National Historic Preservation Month. It's the 50th anniversary of the Historic Preservation Law. And our goal with that is to have it on track to be start making the repairs. Internally, within the depot, we're looking at, we have some offices in the back to be filled by various city groups. And then, much to Stephanie's activities and help and some of my desires, we're going to put it in as a museum and a tourist stop so that people can enjoy the history of transportation. And the reason for the three different sessions that we've had here was leading up to this, so that we can recognize our transportation history, we can recognize the importance. The thing that was really impressive to me when we did a walkthrough was to look at the old portions, the buff of these stands are there, the old ticket stands are there, the windows are the same. And so what you're looking at right now, when you're talking historic preservation, I was at a conference in Savannah, Georgia, and when I was at the conference in Savannah, I talked to some people about the bus depots. And I have not found but one, and that's a tourism place, that still is a bus depot. Outside, they look like bus depots. Inside, they're restaurants. One of them belongs to an architect, another, a couple of others are offices. Well, our goal is to bring back so that when you people come into town, you can see the bus stop. And it's what it was. It needs new flooring, it needs a lot of things. But we're starting out with some of the key components still in place. Now, that's the end of my speech. And I want to thank you.
We have two presenters. Read about both of them. Start with Dave. Dave Hunt's current position is with the Pocatello Public Transit, director and ADA coordinator. He was born and raised in the Magic Valley of Southeast Idaho. Of South Central Idaho. Dave graduated from Kimberly High School and pursued undergraduate studies at Brigham Young University and Idaho State University. After 2 years religious mission in northern Japan, his fascination with foreign language and culture led to a Bachelor of Arts degree in international studies. Married 36 years, he and his wife Margaret have 6 children, 10 grandchildren, and a host of international exchange students whom they claim as their own. While attending ISU, Dave worked for the city of Pocatello as a bus operator and operations supervisor for the PRT. He continued his education at ISU as time allowed for job-related courses, mostly in public administration and foreign language. With increased responsibility for technical developments in the transit industry, as well as the Americans with Disabilities Act, focusing primarily on human resource management, he enjoys learning, teaching, listening, and otherwise interacting with persons with diverse backgrounds and interests. His hobbies include technology, hunting, hiking, choral music, and leisure time with family and friends. Professional and civic affiliations include City of Pocatello Executive Staff, Bannock Transportation Policy Board, Mayor's ADA 504 Citizens Advisory Committee, Pocatello Iwamizawa Sister Cities Committee, and Idaho International Choral Festival, and Valley Pride. Dave Doran over here is the project manager for the Southeast Idaho Council of Governments, CCOG, which exists to connect the residents and communities of Southeast Idaho to public services and useful resources. David's key duties at CCOG include oversight and management of the Idaho Transportation Department mobility support services, contacts with IPD District 5 and District 6, and management of professional services, contact with other community partners for transit communications, marketing, and project planning functions. Dave has previously and was previously employed with Community Transportation Association of Idaho as a District 5 mobility manager and completed a graduate internship with Idaho Transportation Department in the Environmental Planning Division. David has a Master of Public Administration from Idaho State University and is a member of the Distinguished Phi Kappa Phi Honor Society and Phi Alpha Alpha Honor Society. Dave is an active member on the Blackfoot Mayor's Advisory Committee for Disabilities, Pocatello Mayor's Advisory Committee for Parks and Rec, Pocatello Chamber of Commerce, Military Affairs Committee, Southeast Idaho Area Agency on Aging, Advisory Council, Idaho State University's Phi Kappa Kappa, Board of Directors, the State of Idaho Bicycle Pedestrian Advisory Council, and the Banning Transportation Planning Resort Organization's Bike to Work Committee.
He's busy.
Thank you very much. Pretty impressive, huh? May I remind you to turn off your cell phones if you haven't already and take it away.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Charlie. Sounded like my mother wrote that. I don't know about Dave's mom, but we welcome you all here today. We appreciate you being here. Some of you were here last week. Could I see by a show of hands, just so we know, how many were here last week for the historical presentation? Many of you. Thank you. Thanks for coming back. If you were confused about which Dave is which, I'm Dave Hunt, Director of PRT, and you've heard way more than you wanted to hear about an introduction. So, David?
No, we appreciate you all coming today. I think that we had a pretty good overview of our roles and responsibilities here in the region, and hopefully what we're trying to accomplish with connecting people to public transportation systems.
So we're going to go ahead and we're going to get started here. Dave, I think if you want to cover this slide, you know, this is a really important point of talking about PRT, is that PRT has been around for over 40 years. And that's continuous service here in the region, so.
And actually, 44 years from 1972, and some of you will remember that there was a service called Telobus. You see our picture of our little Wayne busette that we ran back in those days. I'm not saying I was here in 1972. I came along in 1980, so things had changed a little. But as we covered last week, the Telobus and everything leading up to our current role in the city and in the region was primarily for persons with disabilities or persons who are frail, elderly, that sort of thing. And that still is really the core of our service. You may have noticed we had an announcement yesterday about doing some modifications on our fixed route to stay within our budget. Well, if we were pared down to just a real skeletal budget, what would remain would be our special services for persons with disabilities and for our senior citizens. So everything that's on top of that is kind of a bonus for our community. And there's quite a bit, and we'll go through that.
Definitely. So moving on here to our next slide. You know, there's a lot of benefits here to improved public transportation and transportation in general. You think about the array of different transportation alternatives. Public transportation offers us a particular advantage. In specific, countless environmental improvements. And I think that that's kind of a given when you think about the reduction of single occupancy vehicles, and the more people that we get onto a shared use vehicle, the more that our environment will prosper and the less it will suffer from things like emissions. And then, of course, you know, with less emissions, there's also less vehicle congestion, there's less vehicles on the road, and this isn't a real big deal for us around here, but you still, if you think about the vehicle that we'll go and we'll check out a little bit later on, those vehicles hold between 20 and 30 passengers. And so if each one of those individuals is in a single occupancy vehicle, that's 30 different cars on the road at any given time. And that's a tremendous savings in the amount of people who are moving about. Please.
Well, the more people you have on there, do the emissions stay the same?
Well, there is somewhat of a balance there because there is, you know, constant
more
driving
weight,
about.
Yeah.
And it is contingent upon volume. But that's our hope, is that with the more people using public transportation, the less congestion that we do have in our community, you know, the less cars that are emitting pollutants and so forth. Enhanced communities. We have a great asset here. You know, when you think about the fact that Pocatello was recently noted as a place to retire on the cheap, having a public transportation system probably led them to that decision, you know, to that ultimate that end there, and being able to afford to move about in our community, get to where you need to go, and devote those costs or devote those resources to other costs that you might incur. And then, of course, you know, you have improved access. People can get to work without having to own a vehicle, with sufficient volume. Again, going on your point, ma'am, with sufficient volume, we can also preserve our roads and highways. A great example of that is the commuter route that used to go from Pocatello to Aberdeen. And we were boarding about 2,000 rides per month, 2,000 boardings per month. And at that volume, we can determine that there are some savings there to our infrastructure. When we talk about our monetary savings, again, being able to utilize our personal resources to other costs that we might see every month, not having to put those into a personal automobile, insurance, tires, maintenance, fuel, etc. That's a big savings. And of course, you know, when we talk about that savings to the state there too, roads and highways are very expensive. So if we can help preserve that infrastructure, that's a great thing. And then Dave, if you want to talk about maybe some of these too, I know that the increased state and tax revenues, that's an important piece with our multiplier here.
Sure, and I appreciate the comment. One thing I would say about the emissions from our buses, in the transit industry across the country, there's an effort made to minimize those emissions. That's in engine design and in the use of clean fuel alternatives. So you make a very good point. And on that, I want to say, anybody who's got something to say, speak up or raise your hand. We want to keep this just as informal as possible. We want to tell you what you are interested in. So please, let's keep that open. And I appreciate the comment. You know, I had a meeting yesterday for about an hour. Yes, please, Charlie.
In your brief resumes, you didn't mention whether you yourself are using public transportation.
Yes,
yeah.
Regularly.
And I actually used the Blackfoot commuter for years when I was an undergraduate student. That was a valuable resource for me. When I was on a budget, that allowed me to access a job, providing me, myself and my family with insurance options and otherwise a great opportunity that I might not have been able to afford. So yeah, it's a wonderful.
There's a bus stop right outside the door here, right to our door to come to, but we have, 600 members, and how many of them take the bus? I think maybe less than one hand.
Well, we're hoping to change that.
We have a few. I see some familiar faces here. So I know this nice lady on the front row does.
That's one of our goals with today, is that hopefully through this informational session, you'll be more comfortable utilizing this resource. It is here in the community, and it's open to the general public. So that's definitely one of our goals.
Several years ago, my car was in the garage for a month, and I live in the Highland area. And I was able to take the bus everywhere that I wanted to go and at the time I wanted to go and return home. Now, the lectures were being held at ISU. I could take the bus down to the Student Union building. I went to Old Town. I went to the mall, to the grocery store. Everywhere I go, I was able to go when I wanted to go and return home when I wanted to return home. And it was my car recently, I had to buy another car, and I really was debating whether to buy a car or just drive the bus.
Thank you so much for sharing that. I promise you, we didn't pay this nice lady anything to say those kind words. I appreciate that experience.
I had a and route things when I was going from Holt down to the Student Union building before my car went in the garage, so I knew what bus to catch, where I could catch it, and it was wonderful. I was shocked.
And that's one of the things we're really trying to emphasize here is those qualities about the system that really create a community that we want to live in, a community that we're proud of. And that's something that we're showing here is a quality of place. And I think that, you know, you talk about your access and your ability to get around the community when you didn't have an automobile. And we want to make sure that everybody knows that this is a resource, again, for the general public. Anybody can use that and hopefully get where you need to go without having to use your car or maybe just at those times when you don't want to.
You may be interested. There are a lot of different ways we can spend our money. The National Transit Institute has researched this. And actually, the latest publication I looked at showed the cost of one automobile. Maybe you've got one or two or three automobiles within your household. If you can park one of those or get rid of one of those, the savings over the course of a year can be as much as $10,000. $10,000. Now, of course, a lot of people think, well, if fuel prices go too high, maybe I'll consider going on the bus. But, you know, fuel is only one thing. And Dave mentioned earlier, you know, the insurance, every time your tires have to be replaced, your battery wears out, you know, the alternator gives out. These are all costs that accrue because of the volume, the level at which we use our private automobile. So definitely this is a good alternative. Yes, sir.
And that $10,000, I don't know if they took that into account, but you have to consider the taxes you pay, your income tax and stuff.
Absolutely.
So to cover that, you might have actually had to make an extra $14,000 or $16,000 a year.
Yeah.
And cars are incredibly expensive.
Very expensive. But we love them, don't we? We love our personal automobiles. I wouldn't stand here and tell you that I don't depend very much on mine. I happen to live up in the Buckskin area, Rapid Creek Road, and so I've got about a 20-mile commute. When I get to town, I'm happy to park that car and ride the bus, though. Yes, please.
It's a shame Pocatello isn't more bicycle-friendly. I have a friend that rides in just about all conditions, and I'm constantly amazed by it. But when I lived in Pennsylvania, in Allentown, I rode my bike everywhere, and I didn't worry about it.
Yeah.
Here, I'm afraid to do it. Somebody in a huge truck's going to cream me.
Well, you know, we might be able to touch on that here in a little bit, too, because actually all of PRT's vehicles have bike ramps on them. So when you pair public transportation with biking and walking, you actually broaden your network of access there. So that's a really good point. And to talk about funding, if we could, just we want to make sure that we can carry on through this presentation, and then we want to make sure everybody gets a chance to get out on the bus. Okay, so we'll go ahead and keep moving on here. If something really is striking you, though, please continue to ask a question. We want this to be important for you. Talking about the funding, there are some costs associated with public transportation, and typically that's something that people think about. Well, what are the costs to our community? Well, and Dave, please fill in where I have some gaps.
Sure.
The primary source of funding to develop these systems, to operate these systems, is through the Federal Transit Administration. And the Federal Transit Administration is tax funded, so all of us are paying into those different programs through our federal taxes. And we want to make sure that we're being able to take advantage of those here locally. And the Idaho Transportation Department acts as a pass-through for the Federal Transit Administration to providers here in Idaho. Now, the Idaho Transportation Department doesn't contribute a significant amount, actually less than $500,000 a year towards the entire state. And so it's very necessary component to have local buy-in, to have the local match contribution to help leverage that Federal Transit Administration grant. And so you have cities and counties that also contribute funding as well. And that enables us to take advantage of those programs. But that's not the only resource. And PRT does a tremendous amount to sustain these resources by looking to public-private partnerships, for instance, by taking advantage of potential advertising revenues and so forth to really help us get more of that local buy-in and help make these services sustainable.
If you're interested in how that breaks down, for operating assistance, it's 50% Federal Transit Administration, 50% local resources. When I say local resources, that includes Those revenues that we can generate through our programs, we'll talk a little later about bus sign advertising, and we do some non-emergency medical transportation, some contract work that we do that gains us some revenues to offset some of these expenses. You may have noticed yesterday we had an announcement that we are working on consolidating and optimizing our resources for our fixed route services. The funding that's in question over that is that local match. And so as Dave has said, the local support and the local match funding is absolutely critical. In particular, this has to do with the general fund of the city of Pocatello that is budgeted to support public transportation. That's been kind of a fixed amount for at least the last 10 years. Well, you all know what's happened over the last 10 years. The cost of doing business continues to go up. Right now, we're looking pretty good for fuel prices, but you know, rubber for tires and the cost of insurance and so many other things continue to go up over time. So what we're having to do now is to kind of have the service match our revenues. So anything we can do to increase that local base is very important to us.
So what do these funds get you, essentially? Where are we at with the PRT services here locally? And we're very fortunate because this service is very robust, and there's a variety of different services that PRT offers, not only here in the city of Pocatello, but throughout the region. And many of you are probably familiar with this first one here, the fixed route service. And these are the buses with delineated stops throughout the city where you can count on the bus being there at a particular time. You can board it and get off at your next stop easily. And then the core service that Dave mentioned earlier is this demand response service. And that is the tele service here locally. So essentially what you do is you call up about 24 hours ahead of time.
Well, a day in advance. Doesn't have to be 24 hours, but previous day.
Previous day, give them some advance notice, and they'll do a door-to-door service for you. So that's a great service that we have available here in our area. I mentioned this commuter route service. I actually took that service to Blackfoot for a number of years, and as I mentioned, it was a great opportunity for me because at that time, $3 got me to Blackfoot and home. I was able to walk to the stop, and then when I got back into town, I was able to walk back home. Well, it only added about, 45 minutes to an hour to my normal trip day anyway, but I was really able to take advantage of that time to study, to, look on my phone, to do whatever I wanted. I could read or take a nap if I was so inclined. So having that commuter route service is really important too. That really helps connect our communities. And then Dave, do you want to talk about our new transit facility here? It's such a beautiful new building.
We're very fortunate to have this facility, and it came with some sacrifice, and I'm sure you all have heard stories about how we got that and some of the challenges we encountered along the way. But prior to this, and last week, for those of you who were here, you saw some of the old places we have been over the years. We're spoiled. I'll just say it that way. We're very fortunate to have this. Now, just for your information, that is 80% federally funded, 20% locally funded. So we've got a little over $1 million investment from the city of Pocatello for a facility that is worth between $6 and $7 million. So, yes, it came with some sacrifice, very little impact on the general tax fund of the city of Pocatello, but definitely was a challenge to raise the local funds to do that. We're very happy to be there. We invite you to come out and take a tour anytime you'd like to, and we very much appreciate that facility.
And in addition, we also have a new website here. And PRT's new website is a great place to get more information. Everybody seems to be connected these days online. If you don't have access to a computer, you can typically find one at the public library free of cost.
David, we had a question here. Pardon me. She says, where is it? We're located at 5815 South 5th Avenue. So we're right across from the Sheriff's Department on South 5th.
But this new website, this was actually an effort to really increase awareness and provide additional sources of information to the general public. You can go there and learn all about PRT's resources on this website and get some information about some other features that we'll discuss here in just a moment, including the trip planner, as well as our Facebook page. So if I can get back over here, I'll get our PowerPoint back up. But we do have some great resources, and we'll try to share those with you. Talking about this next slide here, this is the PRT trip planner. And PRT worked with Google to create this service. What you can do is you log on to the website, and you go to the trip planner. And then when you get to our trip planner here, you put in your location, where you would like to go. Here's our trip planner pulled up. So you can see off to the left-hand side, there's the start address and then your destination address. You put the date and then the time that you would like to be there. And then you see the green button here, get our PRT route. So then it connects to our Google Maps. And I put my office here, and then 800 Yellowstone is Fred Meyer's. So say I want to get from my office to Fred Meyer's to get some grocery shopping at lunch. Well, you can get there very easily using this system. It tells you where you need to walk. You see over here onto the left-hand side, I'm going to need to make a short walking trip, and then I can catch the bus about a block from my office, and then it's going to take me about 20 minutes or so, less than 20 minutes to get over there to Cedar and Warren, and then I have another short walk.
We don't get where you are.
Yeah, we're not getting the display.
Sorry, I don't have that up.
Sounded good, though.
Well, gosh, I gave a great description to myself there for you. Let's see if I can get that up for you. I'm sorry, I'm having some technical difficulties. Well, hopefully we can have an opportunity to get you connected over there to that trip planner. Again, the link is right here on PRT's website. You get up here to, I believe it's on bus services here.
Yeah, it's on fixed route services.
Fixed route service, mm-hmm. And then they have the trip planner icon. You'll see that located on the web page over here. And that's just another way for you to get information outside of the route brochures.
Excuse me, I can't see.
What do you mean by trip planner?
I'm sorry, that didn't come up, but the trip planner, you put in your information, as I was saying, and it will basically filter out which route would be best for you. And then it will give you directions on how to get to that stop.
You're talking about going from my place to Fred Meyer?
Correct.
Okay.
So that's another way for you to get information on how to do that. A lot of people say, well, I don't know where this bus is going. How do I know which one to get on? That's a good way to do it, is to use that online resource. And again, that's outside of the brochures and outside of just calling PRT in general. You could call PRT and ask them for assistance, and they'd be happy to help you too.
Do you have printed up maps and things?
There are, yep, and there'll be some on the bus out here when we go out there as well.
And if you're really adventurous, you can just catch the bus on the corner and take a 1 hour ride, get a tour of the city.
I did when I got here.
And it helps you kind of put things, doesn't it?
I rode them over and over again to see where they went, check the times of when they were.
Yeah.
And that's how I, because I'm not one to do maps and read maps, so I want visual of what I'm doing and where I'm going and where it goes.
That's a really good way to see and to put that in perspective. And once you get on the bus, your driver is a very, very good resource. The drivers are very friendly and helpful. And you know, the mayor spent some time riding our fixed routes as we were having these discussions last fall. And a comment that he made was that not even so much the drivers, in his experience, the people on the bus were very knowledgeable about where to transfer and, you know, how to get to a particular location. So don't be afraid to give it a try. You'll have plenty of help if you do that.
Dave, do you want to address this slide here? Talking about our partnerships, again, how we're leveraging our local resources and taking advantage of different opportunities here in our community to make a strong service.
Sure, thank you. You know, we're not just in a vacuum here in Pocatello, Idaho. We also need to connect to other parts of the region. And in the public transit world in particular, we're very actively exchanging ideas and trying to connect with those people who are our neighbors. There are services, for instance, for the Shoshone-Bannock tribe. Recently, they've acquired some buses, and we move some people to and from the reservation. To the south of us, we have Cache Valley Transit District. We partner with them and some of our southern services. We actually have a commuter bus that makes 5 round trips per day between Franklin County, Preston in particular, and Logan. So we get a lot of students to the University of Utah, Utah State University. I better get that right. I'll get somebody who'll throw something at me who's a Ute fan or something. But so Utah State and to medical appointments, you name it. So, you know, we try to connect to the north of us. Again, we have Targhee Regional Public Transportation Association, Public Transportation Authority, isn't it, David? David works closely with TRIPTA, as do we, and we coordinate those services. Salt Lake Express, some of you have used Salt Lake Express for transportation to and from Salt Lake City or Rexburg or points in between. Salt Lake Express also is the contractor for Greyhound Lines. Greyhound hasn't served Pocatello since 2004, so Salt Lake Express is the current contractor to connect with all other Greyhound routes across the country. So yeah, it's very important that we coordinate and that we, you know, that we connect with these different places.
And again, bike racks on all the buses. So for those of you who like to ride your bicycle, say you get caught out in some inclement weather, or maybe you're exhausted from your ride in, you can take the bus back easily to maybe where you came from. So it's a very nice addition to our system here. So beyond those partnerships that Dave just mentioned, this is a great picture of the trolley, and we talked about last week the history of the trolley, and Stephanie Pelagi from Old Town Pocatello actually mentioned their acquisition of one of the other trolleys. This is one of the trolleys that's still on the fleet here with PRT, and another wonderful historical asset we have in our community. But there's also all these other partnerships that PRT engages in to strengthen our service, to show their community partnership and to their contribution to really making our community a great place to live. I'll name a couple of these here. Many of you are probably familiar with the Communiversity event, Welcome Back, Orange and Black. It's a great way for students coming into ISU to learn about the region, about Pocatello in particular, and some of the resources we have here. Portnoy Valley Bike to Work. During the month of May, on Bike to Work Month, you can actually ride public transportation for free if you have your bicycle. So that's another great partnership there. Really encourages people to utilize alternative forms of transportation to get where you need to go. The Rosa Parks Project. This is a great project PRT worked on with the Academy Charter School, developing a couple embroidered seats on the bus to commemorate Rosa Parks and the civil rights movement and her stance in taking a seat on the bus. That's a great project there. Works well with our students and bringing up our next generation of people using public transportation too, letting them know that these services are in the community and available to them. Strong presence at the Environmental Fair, the Coral Festival, when PMC had their open house. Many of you are probably familiar with Extreme Home Makeover. When we had that home in the community, PRT provided service for volunteers and staff members, construction workers, that round the clock effort to make that project happen. And then if you look on Pocatello Regional Transit's Facebook page, you'll actually see a recent post about their partnership with the Pocatello Fire Department and the Sheriff's Department. You guys you did an evacuation of a facility, is that correct?
We did. We had a call that there was a facility that had a gas leak or some problems, and this is just within the last few days, responded with one of our buses to evacuate people from that building. And that's happened a few times over time. Some of you might remember the Disney parade downtown. Did any of you happen to get to that? Yeah, we got a few hands there. How many of you actually tried to drive to the site?
Yeah.
Yeah, it got a little congested, didn't it? it was such a big thing, and you know how parking is downtown, it's fairly limited, and we were bringing people in from the region, from Idaho Falls, from the Salt Lake Valley, people coming because that was quite an honor for us to get that Disney parade here. But you just can't get everybody to that location without some bus transportation or some means of doing mass transit. We actually enlisted the help of some of our partners, CART Transportation and some of the private charter lines, Teton Stages and others, came in to help us make that mass movement from Pine Ridge Mall, from the Westwood Village, places where we had a larger parking area where we could move people to that event. When we had the Charlotte fire, we were poised and ready with anywhere from 6 to 10 buses to help evacuate that area. If that fire had gone over the ridge into Johnny Creek, we would have seen some real, I mean, it was bad enough as it was, but we would have had a real problem there. So, and we do exercises regularly for emergency response. We had one recently with the U.S. Postal Service. If they had an anthrax problem or whatever. So, you know, these buses come in handy for a lot of things besides the work that we do day after day after day.
So we mentioned earlier our effort to connect with private entities to help sustain these services. You see here that we have some advertising opportunities. You know, technology, there's been a lot of great developments with our ability to put wraps on buses. And we actually had an intern last semester design this wrap for us in an effort to maybe connect with some ISU partners as some concept designs. This is definitely possible. With our graphic designs and our wraps, you could definitely make something great like this happen. We also see our shelters as a potential future development opportunity. You know, these spaces on the university campus offer shelter to students waiting for the bus, and maybe this is an opportunity for the university to strengthen their program awareness to students and maybe sponsor some of these shelters and help dress those up a little bit. Here you can actually see a bus that was wrapped by Portneuf Medical Center with the Life Flight helicopter. And so as you're driving along, all of a sudden you might be driving next to this helicopter here, and that's a really a marketing advantage for some businesses here. You know, it's not a static billboard. This is a billboard that moves, and we have some great stuff here, and that was our tagline from our intern who designed that internship, is ads that move. And so we have a portfolio now when PRT is engaged with conversations with our different potential partners. We have a portfolio to help explain some of these opportunities in a succinct way, and we hope that that helps provide them an advantage for funding.
And it is a win-win. These are very effective ads, and I'm sure you, in driving around the city, have seen these ads on the buses. So if you've got a name that wants to be needs to be promoted, or a particular anything that you want promoted in the city, it's an excellent medium. You should get online and see some of the creative things. They've got like anacondas wrapped around buses, and it's pretty funny online. So really the sky's the limit for that kind of an ad.
Which really takes us to our new buses, and you guys are actually gonna have an opportunity to see this bus outside in just a few moments. But these buses are currently branded, and this is an older photograph, so when PRT first acquired this, you'll see the Utah Transit Authority up here. These logos have been replaced with PRT logos, of course. However, we still have this brand most people are used to seeing down in Salt Lake City. So this is a great way to get this advertising opportunity out to the general public. We would really like to wrap some of these buses, put some different marketing billboards on these buses, and brand them more from our Pocatello base. So, Dave, do you want to talk a little bit about the acquisition of these new buses? I think that was an important point that was
right.
Earlier.
Well, again, it goes back to the funding resources that we have. We devoted everything we had for capital acquisition when we were building that building that we are now in. So the same funding resources for bus replacement go to bus-related facilities. So our new bus garage and the passenger facilities on South Fifth Avenue, let's just say that they used up our resources for a period of several years. We were fortunate enough to contact Utah Transit Authority. They had 10 of these buses. They're a 30-foot bus. They are made by a company called Optima, which has now been bought out by another company. But these are 2005 manufacture. The average mileage on these over the 10 years that UTA used them was something in the neighborhood of 200,000 miles. Well, at 200,000 miles with our fleet, and we have a very aggressive preventive maintenance program, 200,000 miles is kind of like being broken in. So we run these things sometimes a million miles. And so anyway, we were very fortunate to get 7 of those 10 buses. We could have probably gotten all 10 if we could justify it to the federal government, but 3 of the buses went over to Sun Valley to mountain rides, and we partnered with them also to make this happen. So this was a real blessing for us. Again, these buses are federally funded, so your tax dollars and mine go into the pot, and because of that funding resource, once these buses have reached their useful life or finished their mission for one particular location, they can easily be transferred. Well, I shouldn't say easily. They can be transferred. It took us some time to get them, but they can be transferred to another location like Pocatello. They've been very well taken care of, and we're anxious to show them to you in a little bit.
Yeah, we think that you'll find these buses comfortable and very user-friendly. Dave mentioned earlier the accessibility of these buses, and just to point out that all of these buses are ADA accessible. Wheelchair accessible, so individuals that have mobility impairments can easily board these buses. Several PRT's fleet actually has a kneeling capacity, so as it pulls up to the sidewalk, the front end of the bus will actually lower, and then the ramp will unload from the bus and allow you to easily board onto there. The seats fold up to accommodate wheelchairs and so forth, so it's a very accessible vehicle. So this brings us to our comment question period, and we're going to kind of wrap things up here in the next few minutes, and then we would like to invite all of you out to the bus. During this section, we wanted to mention some of the ways that we're getting information out. Sorry about that. A little clicky there. So we have some brochures, some of these flyers here that you'll see, and I just took a snapshot of this. We have some of those located by the door here, and we're hoping that you'll take a couple. If maybe you have a place where you could help us share this information, that would be great. Our goal is to really get as much information out to the public as possible. So we brought in some of these flyers, and maybe you know a place where information would be good to locate. Please take one and go and post it for us, and have this conversation with somebody who you know in the community who might benefit from using public transportation. That's the best way that we can get information out there, is through word of mouth, through comments like yours, vouching for the how easily it is to use the system and help share these resources with other people. I put these icons on here because, you know, we're really moving forward with technology, and it seems like everybody's connected on their smartphones. I had to go buy a new one the other day, and you know, everything is accessible on our phone. And so we've taken advantage of that, and that was due in part to our partnership with Idaho State University. And we reached out to the College of Business, and we said, how can we help generate awareness of PRT services? How do we market these services using our resources that we have available at low cost? And we actually, we had 60 students in that class, and we got 10, was it 10, 12 marketing?
10 groups.
10 groups. They each produced an executive summary illustrating marketing recommendations that they have for PRT, and then how we judged that. And this was their final class project. So they worked on it throughout the semester using PRT as a case study approach. And then we had the mayor as well as Dave and PRT's operations manager, Skylar Beebe, be the judging panel. And so they got to pitch these recommendations to the mayor and the director and say, this is what we think. And so we really hope that through our partnership with these types of community organizations and institutions, we're creating these win-win scenarios. PRT was able to walk away with some great summaries, including, hey, you guys need to develop your website, you guys need to get on social media, you need to start having these different venues so we can get information out to different generations. And so we really took advantage of that, and this was also a recommendation to improve the website, really provided some standing there to make strides forward. So we're really proud of some of our partnerships there, and we hope you'll take advantage of those new platforms, these social media platforms. It's all you do is you get online, sign up for Facebook if you aren't already, and like PRT's page. And then as you peruse your Facebook account and you see pictures of your grandkids and your friends and family, you'll also see messages from PRT coming up talking about maybe an opportunity to comment on the new route proposals, or maybe that there's a cancellation that you need to be aware of in your morning commute. So it's a great way for us to share information with the community.
I'd like to thank David for his efforts in helping us to get this word out. Now, you may have noticed he's a little younger than I am. You might have noticed that. I saw some of you kind of shaking your heads when he was talking about how we access everything on your smartphone. Okay, I can kind of relate to that. I'm a little slower coming up to speed. There are various ways that you can get this information, and we'd like to help you any way that we can. Certainly, the social media and the online resources are very important to the up-and-coming generation. If we were talking to a marketing class or to an engineering class or someone on campus at ISU, they would all be going like this. Yeah, yeah, give me the app, you know. Make an app for me that'll allow me to do this. So we are catering to them as well as to you. I want to also comment, I had the opportunity to speak with some of you before we started. You are a wonderful group and a wonderful resource for our community. I know that many of you have served and continue to serve on committees to make special things happen in Pocatello. The International Choral Festival, several of you have served on that. Valley Pride, you name it, you're involved, and we appreciate your involvement with that. So I want to thank you again for this opportunity to present, and we'd love to answer any questions that you might have. Yes?
For your last meeting, I asked you if you were going to talk about the new changes for the bus routes, and you said yes, and I haven't seen anything on that.
Okay.
People that ride the bus have lots of questions, and
sure,
all the bus drivers will say, well, get online and look. And some, you know, people don't know how to get online.
Sure.
And if you're making changes, then you need to also get everybody else besides the normal riders that have got questions,
sure,
of where the new routes are going to be,
sure,
where the new stops are going to be, what's going on other than online.
Very good comment, and I was hoping someone would bring that up. You know, realistically, in a meeting like this, it's probably not going to be easy for me to field very specific questions. I would encourage you to contact me, call me, and we'll discuss one-on-one what this means. I will go through very quickly the highlights. For those of you who are familiar with our routes, I'll just quickly run through the highlight of those changes, if that's okay. Are you interested in that?
Yeah.
Okay. Routes A and B, if you're familiar with our system, they are the core routes that run along the valley floor. They serve locations between Idaho State University, Old Town Pocatello, and out north to Pine Ridge Mall and Pocatello Square and everything in between. The other routes, and we've reduced from seven to five in this proposal that we've had, there have been as many as five other routes that feed into these two main routes, okay? Some of those have done well and others have really not caught on. Even though people have said, hey, let's have some service to Indian Hills, well, we tried that for 5 years and we begged them to get on the bus and we just couldn't get a response from Indian Hills, just for an example, okay? That doesn't mean that Indian Hills people are somehow inferior or you know, less intelligent or anything, but it just means that at this point in time, we don't have sufficient demand to justify a fixed route service. So Route A will remain the same as it has been. for years and years in terms of where it serves. The one difference you'll need to know with Route A is that at most every stop, the time will be 7 minutes earlier than the current schedule. Okay, that's important. If you show up at the time that's published right now, you're going to be 7 minutes too late. And again, these proposals are conditional upon being approved by City Council. These are recommendations to City Council to operate within our budget, what we feel is the best bang for the buck, if you will. Route A, that's really the only change. Route B, there's one section of Route B that we're eliminating. For some people, it's good. For other people, it's not so good. So on Route B, we're eliminating stops between East Cedar Street and Warren and Alameda and Yellowstone. So as the bus runs up toward the Highland area, Pocatello Creek and Bench Road, Route B has turned around at Bench Road and then come back down Alameda to Yellowstone. Well, you know, there are about six stoplights there, you know, and some of those we see more than once, but it takes a lot of time to do that. There's a lot of traffic up there. And you know, if you're on the bus from ISU to get out to Pine Ridge Mall, that's just an extra 10 minutes of travel time that you really don't need, especially you feel like you're not getting anywhere if you're stopped at a stoplight for a long time. Does that mean we've quit serving Bench Road? No, it means that we have a bus-to-bus transfer at the south side of Fred Meyer so that those who need to go to the Highland area can continue on to the Highland area or other East Bench locations. So that's really the main change in Route B. There are some other very minor changes for safety reasons that we've done, and I can talk to you about those. The time points otherwise are pretty much the same as they are. Yes, please.
When the City Council approves it.
February.
When it does.
Yes.
Don't assume all of us use computers because we don't.
Sure.
We'd like to see the schedules in the newspaper in large print so people can look at it themselves and analyze whether they are convenient using a bus. If they see that they are, they will use it more often. And by the way, you haven't mentioned the cost, that there is a reduced price for seniors, and there is a package deal you can get, several
Sure.
Please mention those.
Well, if I may interrupt that before you comment on the price, those proposed changes are actually in the Idaho State Journal this morning. So those of you who are interested, you can get more information. Again, Dave and Skyler, Skyler is the operations manager at PRT. Their numbers are listed here, and feel free to contact them with specific questions.
Does it show them out as it is, so people can just follow it and just see where they fit in?
Well, to answer that, there's a cost associated with publishing in the paper. There is just so much detail that it would be very confusing in that format to put everything in the paper. That's an individual schedule.
Well, you could do each one. What's wrong with that? Couldn't they do that as a public service?
Well,
if I may, we really need to continue on, but there were several open houses that were hosted by BRT at City Council to explain these changes, and they are, again, they're listed this morning's paper. And then if you have specific questions that you would like to address, please call PRT. And, you know, that provides a lot of different options there to get that information that you're looking for.
And you,
if you have something beyond that, we'd love to have suggestions.
Right.
But we really would like to get you guys all out on the bus and provide opportunity for more specific questions on how to use this service. So if we could continue on, maybe you could all think about those questions that you might have. And then if you would like to get those addressed, maybe catch one of us after the session is over. Would that be okay?
Yeah, and I sympathize with your point, I really do, but you just have to trust me that the newspaper, there's just so much to put in there that it just wouldn't be practical to do a good tutorial with the newspaper, okay? We might do something like a mailing with your water bill or something that would show those printed schedules, but the newspaper would be a really hard way for us to illustrate the full detail of what we're doing.
Okay, so nobody cut out on us here. We don't want to be done for your car. Take a few moments and please join us outside. We'd love to have you board the bus. And if everybody could please just take a seat once you get on there, and then we'll hopefully be able to address your questions.
David, we didn't get back to the cost, and the question's been raised again. If you're just paying cash to ride the bus, The full fare is $1 for a one-way trip. If you are a senior citizen, between the hours of 9 a.m. and 3 p.m., it's half that. It's 50 cents, okay? That's the most expensive way to use the bus. We have discount programs. We have discount ticket books that make the ride. We'll get the ramp down for you here. You know this drill, don't you? We would have on a typical weekday 28 buses running.
So on a typical weekday during peak service, they have about 28 buses running. Now this is throughout our 7-county region, again, with the demand response and our commuter routes and so forth. So you'll notice that as we go around, BRT will make stops. Typically, the drivers make off-board announcements.
Yes.
So as we approach a stop, the drivers will make an audible announcement. You'll want to be looking out for your area. So if you see, oh, I'm coming upon the courthouse here, or maybe KPBI, I know that I'm getting close to my destination. You want to keep track of where you're at so you can get off at the right place. Now, if you have a question, maybe you can ask the driver, but if you know where you're going and you know what you're doing, you know where you want to get off, when you approach your stop, you'll see the yellow cord here. Just go ahead and give that a tug. Please, anybody, go ahead and tug it.
Someone already has. I have a next stop requested.
So what that does is that signals to the driver is that we have a stop request. And then he can take action there to stop the vehicle and let you off.
Monday through Friday. On Saturdays, we run only those core A and B routes.
So there's a question, what are the times and what are the days? So the earliest schedule is about 6:14 until 6:40 in the evening on weekdays. So Monday through Friday. On Saturday, A and B routes. A and B only.
Slightly
shorter route time.
The demand buses do go on Saturday.
And let's see, did we miss anything else?
$2 per demand bus.
Okay, $2 per demand bus per trip. And we mentioned some of the earlier costs earlier, $1 for fixed route. And then seniors are by donation.
45 cents. what the average ticket is if you buy a whole book.
Okay. Yep. So you can buy books of passes. You can buy them individually for the whole day. You can even buy them for the whole month or the semester. And again, those are easy to carry, and you just show the driver as you board. Yes. Yeah, so the Area Agency on Aging, through the Older Americans Act, provides Title 3B funding to PRT. And so that allows seniors in our area to ride by donation.
For the special service.
Well, they'll go out in the truck about SNCS.
Thank you. Appreciate you coming with us.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming. Appreciate you.
Thank you very much.
You're most welcome.
Dave, I was telling Dave, I think it'd be a good idea if you could run a bus up to the community-based outpatient clinic.